creation. Oh, my soul, praise him, for he is my health and salvation. All ye who hear, now to his temple draw near. Join me in glad adoration. Praise to the Lord who o'er all things so wondrously reigneth. Shelters thee under his wings, yes, so gently sustaineth. Hast thou not seen how the desires of men granted in that he ordaineth? Praise to the Lord who doth prosper thy work and defend thee. Surely his goodness and mercy here daily attend thee. Ponder anew what the Almighty can do, if with his love he befriend thee. Praise to the Lord, O let all that is in me adore him. All that hath life and breath now come with praises before him. Let the amen sound from his people again, gladly forever adore him.
And it truly is a wonderful name of the Lord God Almighty that we serve. Number 118, his name is wonderful.
His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. He is a mighty King, Master of everything. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. He's the great Shepherd, the Rock of all ages, Almighty God is he. Bow down before him, love and adore him. His name is wonderful, Jesus my Lord.
His name truly is wonderful, and there's something about that name, number 83.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. There's just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus. Like the fragrance after the rain. Jesus, 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 let all heaven and earth proclaim. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something about that name.
Keep playing, Flo. Have you ever really thought about what that name means to you? Have you ever just thought and said the name of Jesus and thought to yourself, what does it truly mean? How does it touch my life? How does it affect me? Is he truly master and savior of my life? Is he the sweet-smelling aroma of a fragrance after rain? Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. One day all heaven and earth will proclaim. Sing with me.
Kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something about that name.
what is it about that name, the name that every knee should bow and every tongue confess one day that he is Lord? Number 34. Every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. He is Lord, he is Lord. He is risen from the dead and he is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Congregation hymn number 43, all hail the power of Jesus' name. Face many different challenges, and one challenge we're going to face is the day we stand before our Creator and answer for our life. I stood in the courtroom, the judge turned my way. Looks like you're guilty. Now what do you say? I spoke up, Your Honor. I have no defense. But that's when mercy walked in. Pleaded my case, called to the stand, was God's saving grace. The blood was presented that covered my sins. was forgiven when mercy walked in. Well, I stood there in wonder, how could this be? Someone so guilty had just been set free. My chains, they were broken. I felt born again the moment that mercy walked in. Mercy walked in and pleaded my case, called to the stand God's saving grace. The blood was presented that covered my sin, now forgiven when mercy walked in. Yes, the blood was presented that covered my sin. I was forgiven when mercy walked in. You'll turn your Bibles this morning to Psalm 7. Psalm 7. Mrs. Smart was fumbling in her purse for an offering at church when a large television remote fell out and clattered to the aisle. The curious usher bent over to retrieve it for her and whispered, "Do you always carry your TV remote to church?" "No," she replied. "My husband refused to come with me this morning, and I figured this was the most evil thing I could do to get even with him." As we'll see in Psalm 7 today, David was looking for vindication with regard to the one who brought allegations against him. David's confidence, we'll see, was in the divine judge and only him. So Psalm 7, starting in verse 1, it says, "Shigion of David, which he sang unto the Lord, concerning the words of Cush the Benjamite. O Lord my God, in thee do I put my trust. Save me from all them that persecute me and deliver me. Lest he tear my soul like a lion, rendering it in pieces, while there is none to deliver. O Lord my God, if I have done this, if there be iniquity in my hands, if I have rewarded evil unto him that was at peace with me, yea, I've delivered him that without cause is mine enemy. Let the enemy persecute my soul and take it. Yea, let him tread down my life upon the earth and lay my honor in the dust. Shelah. Arise, O Lord, in thine anger. Lift up thyself because of the rage of mine enemies, and awake for me to the judgment that thou hast commanded. So shall the congregation of people compass thee about. For their sakes, therefore, return thou on high. The Lord shall judge the people. Judge me, O Lord, according to my righteousness and according to my integrity that is in me. O let the wickedness of the wicked come to an end, but establish the just. For the righteous God trieth the hearts and the reins. My defense is of God, which saveth the upright in heart. God judges the righteous, and God is angry with the wicked every day. If he turn not, he will whet his sword. He hath bent his bow and made it ready. He hath also prepared for him the instruments of death. He ordaineth his arrow against the persecutors. Behold, he
travaileth with iniquity, and hath conceived mischief, and brought forth falsehood. He made a pit, and digged it, and is fallen into the ditch which he made. His mischief shall return upon his own head, and his violent dealing shall come down upon his own pate. I will praise the Lord according to his righteousness, and will sing praise to the name of the Lord Most High. Let us pray. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, we thank you for your words this morning, and we may glean out of this something we can apply to our own lives. And Lord, just allow your Spirit to be used, me to be used by him this morning. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We've been looking in Sunday school recently at the story of Abraham. And Abraham had the utmost confidence that God would bring judgment against the wicked. In Genesis 18:25, it says, "That be far from thee to do after this manner, to slay the righteous with the wicked, and that the righteous should be as the wicked. That be far from thee. Shall not the judge of all the earth do right?" But notice in this psalm, it starts out with, he sang. David sang this words. David was a musician. I can't say a word real easy. He would play the harp. He'd play the instruments. And he probably loved to sing. And he sang these verses that day to indicate also, though, that this was one that he sang by himself. It was a vocal solo. David lifted his voice to the Lord that day. And he lifted it concerning the words of Cush the Benjamite, who went against him. Somebody brought false charges. And he starts out, "O Lord my God, in thee do I put my trust. Save me from all them that persecute me and deliver me. Lest he tear my soul like a lion, rendering it in pieces, while there is none to deliver." David begins his praying and his song of deliverance with, "Save me, deliver me." This appeal is based on his personal trust in God. He knew God was the only one who could save him. But notice that this attack on the enemy was personal to David. He said, "Persecute me." He said, "Deliver me." And he talks about my soul. But also, if you'll see in these verses and some of the other verses, the attack on David wasn't made by a bunch of people. It was made by one person. It says in verse 2, "Lest he tear my soul." In verse 4, if I have rewarded evil unto him, and I have delivered him." Notice it's specifically talking about one person that was persecuting David, was saying things about him that weren't true, and it put David in a situation because other people believed this Cush. The situation appears to involve David defending himself from false accusations made against him by his enemy, one of which is to be particularly feared, because he says this enemy is violent as an angry lion. Now, we know David went up against a lion once, but he was scared of this one. This Cush lied about David, and this left Saul to pursue David. So David fled to the one place he could find refuge, and that was in the Lord. Because the Lord knew that David was innocent of all the accusations. David knew that if God did not rescue him, no one could. So he goes on in verse 3, "O Lord my God, if I have done this, if there be iniquity in my hands, if I have rewarded evil unto him that was at peace with me, yea, I have delivered him that without cause is my enemy." You can see in these verses that these slanderous charges was that David had done evil to the one that was at peace with him. He was accused of robbing him without cause. But David affirmed his innocence before the Lord and asked the supreme judge to vindicate him, because he says, "My hands are clean." Now, David was not claiming he was sinless. What he was stating is that I'm blameless in this action and in these motives that they're bringing against me. You know, unjust and innocent suffering in this world is something I don't understand. I can't even try to begin to understand it. But I want to say this to you. I know somebody who does understand it. And he's going to explain it one day to us. There are things in my life, and I'm sure things in your life, that we don't understand. I can't explain your trouble because I don't even know some of the things I'm going through. But he's going to explain it one day. I used to tell the youth when I was teaching them that when we get to heaven, the first thing we're going to say is, of course. That's why. Now I understand. He goes on in verse 5, let the enemy persecute my soul and take it. Yea, let him tread down my life upon the earth and lay my honor in the dust. Selah. David was certain he didn't deserve to be persecuted in this way, especially for this reason. He reveals a conviction of personal innocence. It's almost the same as what Job did when he had his debate with his friends. In Job 31, he was willing to put his protest in the form of an oath to accept any punishment he justly deserved. So in 1 Kings 8, you can see David says, if any man trespass against his neighbor, and an oath be laid upon him to cause him to swear, and the oath come before thine altar in this house, then hear thou in heaven, and do, and judge thy servants, commending the wicked, to bring his way upon his head and justify the righteous, to give him according to his righteousness. So here, according to God's word, when a man sustained injury or was brought charges against them from someone, even if they couldn't bring direct evidence that they were not guilty of this crime or thing they're saying against them, the accused was permitted to come before the altar of God and purge themselves with a personal oath. In this oath, David concludes by swearing that if his guilt is proven, so he's doing an oath to God, he said, if my guilt is proven, I will pay with the loss of my life. I'll be given over to the hand of my enemy. He was willing to accept God's judgment, and should the Lord find him guilty, he was willing to accept his discipline. But he knew that his hands were pure in this matter. These are self-pronounced curses. They're powerful proclamations of innocence. Now, you're not claiming to be sinless. You're claiming to be innocent in any context when you're being falsely accused. Job was another man who was falsely accused. In Job 31, he says, does he not see my ways and number all my steps? If I have walked in falsehood, and my foot has hastened after deceit, let him weigh me with accurate scales, and let God know my iniquity. I desire nothing more than to have my heart and life weighed in such balances and searched out by an all-seeing God. Now, the accusations against David were not specifically stated, but I looked up different commentaries, and they offer different suggestions based on context and subject matter and record of Israel's king. Those who sought David's life accused him of one of the two crimes below, that he attempted to take vengeance upon God's anointed, King Saul. In 1 Samuel 24, 1 through 12, David had an opportunity to kill Saul while he slept. But instead, he merely cut off the corner of his robe and left. So he was taking vengeance on God's anointed. Or they could have brought against him that he committed fraud or a dishonest act because he actually plundered from the king. This was a serious offense that was aggravated by allegations that he committed a wrong against a friend whom he trusted. he committed this theft against his fellow countrymen. What was this theft? He cut off the corner of his robe. So they said, we got to bring something against him. So he brought vengeance upon God's anointed, and he robbed a piece of the corner of his robe. It seems dark for David. But now we see the morning light in verse 6. It says, "Arise, O Lord, in thine anger. Lift up thyself because of the rage of mine enemies, and awake for me to the judgment that thou hast commanded." You know, David many times over could have taken things in his own hands, but in faith turned Saul and his scheming enemies over to the Lord. He says, "Arise, O Lord." You know, that's kind of a bold cry, because the Bible tells us God never slumbers or nor sleeps. So to cry out and say, "Arise, O Lord. Lord, I need immediate justice against these people. Arise in anger, Lord, and vindicate me with fury of your enemies." David is not thinking here of the final world judgment. He's not thinking of the end of the times when God takes care of everything. He says, "I want immediate action." Have you ever done that when someone's done you wrong? Or have you thought about, what can I do to get even? How can I get back to them? What can I do? Just cry out, "Arise, O Lord, take care of it." But we have to make sure our own hands are clean first, though. Especially before we take an oath to God like that. He knows the Lord will consider the case of a single petitioner. David knows that each individual has a place in the thoughts of the Lord. Matthew 10, 29 through 31 says, "And not two sparrows sold for a farthing? And one of them shall not fall on the ground without your Father. But the very hairs on your head are all numbered. Fear ye not, therefore, ye are of more value than many sparrows." This rage that David was facing from his enemies was so violent, it was like a flood rising over riverbanks, and just it was overwhelming him. And when that happens, prayer is the only resort that we have. And in the face of calamity, David doesn't argue with what's going on. He doesn't argue with the people. He just submits to God and to the judgment of God. He did not retaliate when he was insulted. He didn't threaten revenge when he was suffering. He left his case in the hands of God, who always judges fairly. Jesus could have been inflicted. Jesus could have inflicted any kind of punishment on his persecutors. He could have done anything he wanted to do to his persecutors by just snapping his fingers, by just a thought in his head. But he gives us an example where to follow. He committed his cause to the one who is the righteous judge, 1 Peter 2:23, who when he was reviled, reviled not again. And when he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judges rightly. Verse 7, "So shall the congregation of the people compass thee about for their sakes, therefore return thou on high." David links now his own vindication to the trial of humanity like the courts in heaven. The Lord takes his place in the courtroom. He stands up to judge his people. And Isaiah 3:5 says the Lord stands up to plead his own cause, or the cause of his son against the Jews that rejected him, and the scribes and the Pharisees that led them to a hostile opinion of him. And he stands to judge the people. So God arises from his throne, stands up in defense of his cause, and avenges himself on a wicked and ungrateful people. God's going to have his way someday. We don't like the things going on in this world. Have we cried out to God? "Arise, O Lord." The Lord shall judge the people in verse 8. "Judge me, O Lord, according to my righteousness and according to my integrity that is in me. This universal trial has started. David appeals to God for a favorable judgment upon himself on the grounds of his own integrity. It says, my righteousness, my integrity. Again, he's not declaring he's sinless, but he said, I'm innocent in this case. David pleaded for judgment that would reveal his own righteousness. Verses 6 through 8 speak of personal vindication and world judgment. Lord, judge me, O Lord. He's not saying, judge me to reveal my sins. He's saying, judge me, O Lord, on my righteousness. Vindicate me. Save me. Verse 9, let the wickedness of the wicked come to an end, but establish the just, for the righteous God trieth the hearts and the reins. The righteous God trieth. The God who knows all, the omnisciency of God. He knows your heart, your affections, your mind, your motives of all men. Jeremiah wrote in Jeremiah 17:10, I, the Lord, search the heart and examine the mind to reward each person according to their conduct, according to what their deed deserves. A man's own heart is a mystery, and God alone can fathom it. David had confidence in God. Clearly seen in verses 9 through 10, he says, the outcome is assured by the very nature of God that the righteous will be preserved while the wicked will suffer the wrath of God. David asked for judgment to fall upon the wicked, those who seek his destruction, on the grounds that in such true assessment of life, all evil must be revealed as causing its own condemnation. So righteousness is not just conforming outwardly to the things of this world. It says God examines the heart and the mind. Our full minds and hearts, our thoughts and our emotions are all under divine scrutiny. So when someone brings something against us, are you willing enough to say, oh Lord, I make an oath, destroy them. Lord, make this world right. Change our country. But are you righteous enough to be asking God for that? Not just in the way you act, but in your mind and your heart? None can look to God as protective shield except those that are inwardly righteous. Since God is a righteous God who knows the minds and the hearts of men, wickedness must surely come to an end and righteousness be established. Verse 10, my defense is of God, which saveth the upright in heart. He notes defense, his shield. Same idea we saw in Psalms 5:2 when we studied it. For you bless the godly, O Lord, you surround them with your shield of love. This wasn't just defense as to defend one part of his body. He knew that God would shield him fully. It's one of the characteristics of God that while he will punish the wicked, he will show favor to the righteous. While he brings deserved punishment upon the one, he will show favor to the other. Because God judges the righteous, and God is angry with the wicked every day. You notice, God is angry with the wicked every day. That's his unchanging nature. To be hostile at all to those who are righteous would offend them. He doesn't have to assemble a special court to judge sinners. Because if you notice in these verses now from 11 on, he allows sinners to reap the sad consequences of their sins day by day. Romans 1:24 says, wherefore God has gave them up to uncleanliness through the lust of their own hearts to dishonor their own bodies between themselves. God gave them up to uncleanliness. God didn't put anything into them. He just left what was there to pollute their own nature. He withdrew his restraints from them, to say. But obedient believers can take comfort in the fact that God's that people's wickedness does not go unnoticed by God. But they can also be advised that vengeance belongs to the Lord and He will repay. We all know that verse, Deuteronomy 32:35. To He belongeth vengeance and recompense. Their foot shall slide in due time, for the day of their calamity is at hand, and the things that shall come upon them make haste. And Romans 12:19, dearly beloved, avenge not yourself, but rather give place unto wrath, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. So we see now that the enemy that has attacked David is just proving their own guilt by their actions. Verse 12, if he turn not, he will whet his sword, he will bend his bow and make it ready. He hath also prepared for him the instrument of death, he ordaineth his arrows against the persecutors. So now you don't only see the divine judge, but you see the divine warrior. God's action of judgment against the unrepented is stated in terms of earthly combat with the sword and the bow. You see the imagery of deadly weapons that stand before this sinner who stubbornly advances to his own doom because he will not turn to God and accept His grace and mercy. Behold, in verse 14, he travaileth with iniquity. He hath conceived mischief. He hath brought forth falsehood. This nature of the wicked, this iniquity, this mischief, this falsehood, it appears to be like a person who covers himself with a shroud made of evil desires. His whole career of wickedness is described here. Its beginning, its actions, its endings. That's what James had in mind when he wrote in James 1:15, then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. When the desire that we have naturally is allowed to act, the result is sin. The labor to do evil, it characterizes these people who are falling to their own devices, who have given in to the things of this world, and God has allowed them to get trapped in their own plans. If someone conceives trouble, it will not produce its intended results. Instead, the evil scheme will be turned back on the plotter. This is retribution from God. You know, God said in His Word that the punishment should fit the crime. In Exodus 21, He said, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, a hand for a hand, a foot for a foot, burning for burning, wound for wound, stripe for stripe. In Matthew 26:52, then said Jesus unto them, put up again thy sword into his place, for all that take the sword shall perish with the sword. But God shows us in verse 15 what they actually have done in their sin. He made a pit and digged it and has fallen into the pit which he made. This sinner, his work fails to accomplish its purpose. And their sin actually becomes a snare that they're caught up in. They dig a pit to catch someone else but fall in themselves. The trouble they cause will come back on their own heads. That's how God takes care of things in this world. He says, I'm going to give you over to it. And has He not in our United States? But are we on our hands and knees crying out to God, oh God, please arise, take vengeance against the things that are happening in this world? Do not be deceived, Galatians 6:7. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. There is a work of divine retribution at work in this world, and no one can escape it. Verse 16, his mischief shall return upon his own head, and his violent dealings shall come down upon his own pate. David says, the plans and methods of my enemy ultimately cause their own ruin. So what's left for David to do? I will praise the Lord according to his righteousness. I will sing praise to the name of the Lord Most High. All these thoughts that are running through David's head as he produces this song that he's singing about all the trials and troubles that he has and the people that are speaking falsely against him. And Lord, I'm willing to tell you that you know how righteous I am. You can vindicate me. And Lord, if I am guilty of any of this, I make an oath to you now, Lord, that if I'm guilty of any of this, then kill me. Allow my enemy to take me over. But he knows now that God's worthy of praise. Not because of his righteousness, but because of his unquestionable response to David's appeal of judgment. David is sure God will help. And that causes him to triumph, to rejoice, to trust in the Lord Most High for vindication. God will deal with sin and wickedness, and he will finally one day eliminate it from his universe. But instead of coming up with the next good program to get people in church, instead of trying to find a way to change our country, we need to be on our hands and knees and crying, arise, O Lord. Vindicate. We have to then examine our own selves. Are we righteous enough to ask God to do that? You know, it's easy when it's a false accusation against you, and you know that it's his word against my word, and I know I'm true, and I have no problem standing before God saying, I have no problem with this. God, vindicate me because you know that I'm right. You see all, that's easy. But what about when it comes to the point that we want God to make changes in this world? Well, it's not just our church. There's many, many churches empty. People don't want to praise God anymore. That's what God said would happen in end times. But that should even stir us even more to reach people for him. To not take a stand of the things that are happening in this world and just accept them for what they are. We need to be on our hands and knees crying, oh Lord, vindicate us. But are we righteous enough to do that? The song that I sung, I stand in the courtroom, and it looks like you're guilty. Now, what do you say? We need to make sure that we're under the righteousness of Christ in our lives and living for him. And then cry out, oh Lord, and he will hear our cry and he will vindicate us and the wicked will not prevail. He will. Let's pray. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, David cried out for vindication. David cried out, Lord, it's time. You know I'm right. Things aren't going to change, Lord, till we cry out. But Lord, we need to be right in our own lives. And then we cry, Lord, you know I'm right. Lord, allow this evil in this world to be dealt with. Lord, I see you allowing them to be handed over to their own evil. But Lord, we want to see the day when they fall into that pit. And we're getting closer every day. But Lord, just thank you for the message of David. David placed his full trust in you, enough that he was willing to make an oath with you, Lord, that if there anything be against him, then I should be the one, because I'm not righteous enough to be here. And Lord, I just pray that you continue to convict our lives and draw us closer to you. And may we take a stand for you in this world and cry out, "Arise, O Lord." Sometimes I think he's just standing there waiting. He's got his bow, and he's got his arrow, and he's got his sword, and he's standing there waiting for us to cry out so he can draw the bow back and pull the sword out of the sheath. And Lord, I cry out to you this morning, "Arise, O Lord, and cleanse this wicked world." We pray all this in Jesus' name. The only way we do that is by trusting him. Number 480, only trust him. Come every soul, my sin oppressed, there's mercy with the Lord, and he will surely give you rest by trusting in his word. Only trust him, only trust him, only trust him now. He is able, he will save you now. Thank you all for being here this morning. What it was just a joy to share what the Lord laid upon my heart, and I hope it has blessed you and drawn you closer to him this morning. And just be in prayer, not just for our church, but for all the churches. We need to be on our knees to God. P, would you dismiss us, please?
Thank you so much for the message you heard.